So economic impact will happen only if you build systems in India. If you see the other countries like China, Taiwan, the only difference between us and them is they build systems.
Mr. Susurla V S Suresh, who's an engineer, author, mentor, and inventor. So, Mr. Suresh, our volunteers will help you with the mic. So, let me introduce you to him. He's an electronics engineer by profession with an MS degree in embedded systems and product design from IIT Madras. Wonderful. You have a good ovation, rousing a welcome from the audience. They're looking forward to that, yeah? So let me quickly complete his intro. His MS thesis involved the complete design, development, and testing of a portable handheld biomedical device, basically a wireless ECG system. This led to an industrial-grade product, the technology being approved and taken over by an indigenous company working in the field of medical electronics. His areas of research include medical electronic system design, analog signal processing, digital signal processing, and satellite hardware software technology. His experiences include as a principal engineer with Decare Technologies, Vice President of Robotics, Academy of Robotics, Senior Project Officer at IIT Madras, Senior Systems Engineer at Siemens, and Assistant Manager at Tata Motors. Today, Mr. Suresh will share his insights with us on the need for electronic systems design in India, the experiences, opportunities, and challenges for students. Please welcome him once again with a big round of applause. Thank you. Over to you, Mr. Suresh.
Thank you very much for such a beautiful introduction. Good afternoon, friends, students, delegates, and almost everyone, the volunteers. I think it's a great event that is happening. I have been witnessing since morning. It's wonderful here. Thank you so much, the TechFest team. Okay, the topic, as he has said, is the need for electronic systems design in India. My experiences, opportunities, challenges, and finally impact on national economy. Before starting the presentation, I just want to tell you why this topic is so important and very close to my heart. Because as he has said, first of all, I am an electronics engineer, and as a responsible citizen, I firmly believe that each and every one of us as engineers should contribute to the technology of the nation and also bring about an economic change in the country. Because, see, we are all blessed people here in this auditorium, but there are so many people out there who do not have money, they do not have the home, and it's all because of the national economy. So if we as engineers work towards development of technology, indigenous technology, and contribute to the economic growth of the nation, I believe it will be of great help for the nation. That's the reason why I have chosen this topic. And I would like to highlight some of the important aspects of economy, the country's GDP, and what are the different industries that affect the GDP of this nation, especially focusing on electronics. May I know how many of you are electronic engineers here? Oh, awesome. Thank you. Okay, let me proceed, please. Yeah, I think the colleague has already given a brief intro. I have a BE in electronics and MS in system design, and I'm pursuing business management from IIM Calcutta. I have around 7+ years of experience with, I worked with manufacturing, IT, research, industries, to name a few, Tata Motors, Siemens, IIT Madras, AOR, Decare. Till now, in my 7 years of career, I have designed around 13 electronic systems from scratch as a part of my research and as a part of the industries that I worked for. I have around 5 international publications in IEEE, and I am a co-inventor of 2 patents. And I've independently authored a book on electronics, which is very handy and which will be useful for you for preparation of your GATE or IES or Bell ISRO. And I have addressed around 800+ students in IIT and outside IIT Madras. And I am also a mentor to 2 of the startups. One startup is of my own student of IIT Madras. And the second one is the Startup Labs, which I am also representing here outside this. If you have time, please go and visit the Startup Lab once. There's a lot of good stuff there waiting for you. Please. a small disclaimer. Whatever information I have put here is from the web and from the trusted websites with no intentions of copyright infringement or hurting anyone's sentiments. The contents are in the sequence. I would like to describe what are the two important components of the electronics industry of India, the current scenario of the Indian electronics, and the economic impact the Indian electronics or the indigenous systems have. What are the opportunities that we have in India for all the engineers like you, and the current challenges which are very important, and as an engineer, what role you can play? Okay, being a responsible citizen, what role you can play to bring about a small change towards the economic growth of the nation. I hope the slides are clear to you, right? Can you see? Can you please turn off some lights? Is it clear now? Better? You can shift forward otherwise. There's so many seats vacant. Fine. I would like to proceed with your permission. See, the Indian electronics industry is basically divided into two segments. One is the VLSI and other is the hardware/board or system design. VLSI, as you know, is very large scale integration, which involves integrated chips designs, basically the microcontrollers, the op-amps, and all those chips. And they need a big fabrication facility if you want to, design and fabricate chips in India. It's a very costly process. And in India, as far as I know, I don't think we fabricate any chip of very large scale integration. Coming to the second sector, which is the hardware segment, it basically involves what the chips that are being designed and developed in VLSI being used in system design. Okay. And making systems is not that complicated. If you know the basics well, it is assured that you can build good systems. As one of the former presenters has presented, one thing which is lacking in the curriculum or in the Indian industry, I believe, is a bit lack of reliability and quality. As our former speaker has also pointed rightly. So if you know the theory well, and if you know the concepts well, I want to assure you that each one of you here can be a system designer one day, which we feel right now is almost impossible, because the curriculum that we have is only focusing on theory and with very little practical implication to the industrial world. So there's a big gap between the academia and the industry. And when the student leaves the engineering college, he or she finds it very difficult to be with the crowd in the industry, because they follow certain processes, there are certain standards, which is completely different from the cool-going culture in engineering college. Coming to the hardware board systems design, so we basically use the chips that are designed, and we need a very simple laboratory to integrate the chips together and build a system of our choice. Both of these sectors play a considerable role in the Indian economy, especially the second one, the hardware board and system design. So I want to bring to your notice that the second segment is what most of the engineers currently can definitely focus on and build a career. If you see, India's GDP basically is contributed by agriculture, industry, and services. Industry is only 25%, agriculture is 22%, and services is around 53%. And if you see the electronics, the share of electronics manufacturing in GDP is only 1.7%, which is much lesser as compared to the other technologically advanced countries like Taiwan, South Korea, and China. This is something which is sad, but I believe with the kind of literature that is available on the net and with the kind of new policies that the government is making for the Make in India and other policies like that, the hardware design in India will start booming up from 2015 to 2020. So for engineers, especially the electronics engineers, I feel now you should not focus on moving to any company that comes to your campus or something. You start learning system designing, start learning the core of electronics. And there are statistics which say that by 2020, there is around $400 billion market of the electronics industry. So electronics engineers, please think before moving to other cross-functional companies and start making your career in your core in which you have spent 4 years of your life. If you see, India exports 17 exports goods worth 17% of India's GDP. But one thing which is sad is India also imports around 16% of its GDP. So if you see, the net is almost very less, and hence the economic impact doesn't happen much. So economic impact will happen only if you build systems in India. If you see the other countries like China, Taiwan, the only difference between us and them is they build systems. And they build hardware and they export. Most of the electronic instruments which we use in our laboratory, you can see for yourself, the oscilloscope, the signal generator, you know, some measuring equipment. If you see, all of them are almost imported. Why can't we make them? Have you ever thought of that? We can make it. I have been with the system design teams, you know, in India and abroad, and I've seen that it is quite possible with whatever curriculum we really study in our colleges. If you study well, and if you grasp the concepts, even we can design systems in India. I think we have a gentleman here from Vikram Sarabhai Space Center. Hello, sir. So we have some people, great people in India here sitting in front of us who have designed systems for the country. So it is possible. People like this, you should be motivated rather than just relying on importing technology and just using. We should focus on building technology because that is how we can create an economic impact, which is good for you and for the entire nation. I put a small slide with the, you know, import statistics, which say, sadly, that in last 1 year, the electronic goods import has increased by 22.5%, which will again reduce by 2020. But this is a small slide which I wanted to put. This is a very powerful statement. Please read it. India's technology sector is expected to be 1 trillion opportunity in the next 5 to 7 years. That include $400 billion of hardware. Do you see this? Do you see this? This belongs to all the electronics engineers like you here, which we are neglecting right now. The second one is $350 billion of software and $250 billion of telecom and IoT. The tech sector should potentially contribute 25% of India's GDP, okay, is expected to reach in future. And this is by Mr. Ajay Kumar, who is Additional Secretary of DET. As you can see, there's a huge predicted growth for the hardware industry in our country. It will reach $400 billion, and the growth rate is 41.4% that is needed to achieve this. Coming to the ESDM, ESDM basically the electronic system design, maintenance and manufacturing industry in India, basically consists of three important categories which you should be very clear of. The first one which I highlighted is the electronic products, second one is electronic components, and third is design and development services. See, whatever systems we design in India, we import all the chips, import the transistors, resistors, capacitors, everything. So it's there's a reason behind it. In India, it's very difficult to manufacture semiconductor-based systems. Okay, and especially the sensors. Because the sensor technology is a very crucial technology and needs high reliability and precision. So the second one, if you see the electronic components, 24% is domestic made and 76% is imported in our country. If you see the electronic products, which include the automotives, telecom, medical, consumer, industrial, etc., only 44% is made domestically, that too with 76% imported components, and 56% of our requirements are by imports, which is very sad. India generating so many electronics engineers in every year, I think this number is huge right now. The third and the final is the design and development. If you see, the beauty is 100% domestic. Basically, this is where our friends are using all the brains to provide services, okay, to the companies which outsource the work to India. So if we do a lot of work in this, there is a huge scope that the increase in GDP will happen due to the services sector of the country. And the last part is very important for engineers like us who are sitting here, because it includes embedded system design, VLSI and PCB design. Though VLSI is less, but embedded system design and PCB design play a big role. And these things, if you see, we are not taught how to design systems in the college. We are only taught how to analyze. You are given a circuit, what is the current that flows, what is the voltage at a particular node, so and so. We are never taught how to design. How do you learn design then? That is critical, and you'll be able to design only if your concepts are crystal clear. So you need to work very hard and understand all the concepts as much as possible to make that happen, okay? And the PCB design is also an important part, and India, a lot of PCB design is happening for other companies abroad. If you see the growth curve of the design services, which is a good news for engineers like us, by 2020, we are expecting a 13 to 18% growth from 2015. And in the design services, which was the third category that I was talking of, there's a split. 85% is with embedded systems. 8% is VLSI, and 5% is PCB design. So if you see, there's a good news for the electronics engineers sitting in this room. If you learn how to design systems, build systems, which is all about using the components and putting them in a proper way to make a certain system work as per the design, it is quite possible. Our curriculum in engineering is really good, which we don't appreciate, because the curriculum is never mapped to how systems are designed, built, and how they are working in the industry. If you see any machine in the industry, whether it's a lathe machine or whether it's a CNC machine, whether it's a robot, if you dissect it and if you see the design, it will all boil down to your op amps, resistors, transistors, you know, capacitors, microcontrollers, power transistors, etc. Some of the key areas which are playing a huge role in country's economy are wireless products, portable handheld products, consumer electronic products, automobile products, and especially the healthcare. If you see from this slide, there's a huge growth. Though this slide is a bit old, but we are seeing a huge growth. I didn't get the latest data from the web, but we can see the trend that there's a huge market in these areas. Coming to the challenges, this is very important and crucial. Integrated chips, see, we have a subject in engineering called as VLSI, but maybe that may be a one course and we study and we pass. We are never given an opportunity, rather it's not an intentional thing, but fabrication of chips, as I said, is very difficult. So I feel in India, getting an expertise of IC design is definitely difficult. In Indian Institute of Science and at IIT Madras, I have seen, you know, there are some chip design centers, but never fabricated. But coming to the second one, which is the hardware design, okay, especially from the startups also. The big problem why startups fail, and if you see, there are a lot of technology startups which fail, and especially the electronics and the hardware ones, because of lack of hands-on skills. See, you may write an amplifier. You can draw an amplifier, but it may not work the way when you put it on a PCB. Have you ever experienced that? There'll be some drifts, there'll be some offsets and something. Okay, so lack of hands-on skills, lack of knowledge of importance of quality and reliability, and lack of exposure to sales, marketing, and logistics. In startups which I have seen and I have been working with some of my friends, I've seen that they're able to build a product sometimes, but either it's not reliable because of lack of quality, and they also are very young, just out of college, and lack of experience of sales, marketing, and logistics. So the product just lies on the table of the laboratory, which is very, very, you know, sad. This is one of the reasons why startups don't succeed much. The McKinsey report on benchmarking with global standards, if you see, it's clearly mentioned here, okay, that the production planning is low as in India as compared to others. And maintenance, quality, and talent management is another problem. And continuous improvement is something where we need to think upon. How can engineers contribute? As I said, this is just a suggestion from my end based on my past 10 years of experience. If you get a job in core technology, please go for it. Especially if it's in manufacturing center as your first job, I'm telling you, you'll have a beautiful shoot in your career because the experience, the insights that you get from an established manufacturing firm is really worth. The second point is work in reasonably stable technology startups. Sometimes the startups that I have seen and dealt with, there's a lot of chaos because most of the students, as I said, they just graduate and they want to do some stuff. The passion is really good, but the know-how of the processes, how to take a product that you have done real research on to the market is really a very difficult task. A very, very difficult task. So you should, if you get to work in a startup, that's great. Because the kind of exposure you will get in a startup, you will not get in a well-established firm. That's for sure. Because in a startup, you'll see all the departments in front of you. You will see how they're working and how the process flows if they are stable technology startups. Okay? And work in design and development services and not just maintenance or support services. Because in maintenance and support, the technology is already ready. You will never get an opportunity to go into the depth of the subject if you join a job after your graduation from the electronics field I'm talking of, into support and maintenance. So there you will lose an opportunity in the long run of your career. Okay? And learn hardware system design and build indigenous technology which is worth exporting. So when you build systems, first you can reduce the imports that can happen to some extent, and then build a quality system that can be exported where you can, in this way you can contribute a lot to the country. Some of the Indian public and private electronic manufacturing firms in India, which you can always opt for, are DRDO, ISRO, Bell, BHEL, HCL, Godrej, Intex, Voltas, Wipro, to name a few in the public. I think I have also put some private, public and private. And the global electronic manufacturing firms in India are also doing good. A lot of them have opened their R&D centers in India, which is a really good option for you to explore because most of the foreign firms like Texas Instruments, Analog Devices, Maxim, give you an opportunity and a laboratory to design chips, to design circuits, which is a very good for a fresher who is just out of college. And then you have Siemens, Bosch, Samsung, Intel, who work on a lot of operating systems and software development and making device driver development. That's the thing. And Continental. So finally, I would like to say that if possible, build, if it is possible for you, become system designers, become hardware designers, because by 2020, India will have a huge market for hardware design. And if in the next 2-3 years, if you learn these basic skills of designing, the next 20-25 years will be really good because the next boom after IT in India is expected to be, or rather projected, as hardware design. So it's really a good news for all the electronics engineers and the electrical engineers here. And if possible, I'm sure most of the students sitting here have enthusiasm of opening, setting up a startup company of yourself. Please go ahead. get the advice from the mentors to go ahead in the right direction, because that is what lacks. It's not about the enthusiasm or the energy of the candidate, but I feel it's the lack of mentorship because of which the young startups don't succeed. So if required, please go for a mentor, your professor or your teacher, whoever, and ask him or her how to proceed in your, you know, technical work. And my wishes are like, build a R&D facility and manufacturing center in India. Okay, so see you. And there's a stall here for which I'm a mentor. It's called a Startoon Labs. The labs is doing well. It's a fresh startup. And a lot of design is happening here. So I request if you, they're doing a lot of mentorship and I'm also an integral part of that. If you can take some time, your precious time out and visit the stall for a few minutes, there are really, really good things waiting for you. Just give 2 minutes and see. If it's useful, it's good. If it's not, it's up to you. You can contact me at susurlasuresh@gmail.com. I'll be really glad to come in touch with young students like you and help and learn from you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mr. Suresh, for the Thank wonderful you. Inspirational talk.
Thank you.
I think a lot of electronic students will benefit from this.
Awesome. And, I wish that happens.
Yeah. I was introduced to Decay Technologies a couple of years back when they were at one of the Head Start events at a Startup Saturday.
Yeah.
That's when I came to know Crispian Lawrence and
awesome, awesome. So Decay Technologies, for which I work currently, is a beautiful startup.
You should probably tell a couple of lines about that.
Sure. Why not? See, this is a startup that was started in 2011-12, I suppose. And they are building a product which is a footwear. You can just put the footwear, a small electronics portable device that goes into your insole or the shoe. And it is basically designed for navigation of the blind. They also have a map, you know, where you can program the source and the destination. And the technology is very simple. You may be feeling nothing is there. You know what it does? It just tells the blind person, if he has to take a left turn in his map, the hardware in the left foot vibrates. It gives an indication to the person saying, please turn left. And at the next junction, if the right turn he has to take, then the right foot, the electronics in the right foot vibrates. In this way, it is designed to navigate a blind person, okay, to reach a particular destination. I think that's a great job by Educare Technologies. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Suresh. Can one of the volunteers get the memento, please?